We are being watched. A bewildering array of sensors are remotely observing everything on Earth, from crops in Africa to cars parked outside your house. Will these aerial observations help us to save the Earth, or is science beginning to see too far into our lives? To take a long, hard look at remote sensing, I'm joined by four guests with different perspectives on imaging the Earth from space. Robert Gurney from the Environmental Systems Science Centre at the University of Reading. David Baker is a space consultant and editor of Jane's Space Directory. And our regular guest is Jacqueline McGlade from University College London. Jackie is herself an expert on the application of remote sensing to environmental problems. And finally, Robert Llewellyn, the author, presenter and actor. Robert's most famous role is perhaps his least visible as the robot Crichton in Red Dwarf. Robert, let me start with you. Why on earth have we invited you to this programme? Why are you interested in remote sensing?
It is hard to understand, but I've decided I'd actually quite like my own satellite. This is the thing, because I've been reading about it. I don't know very much. I'm very much in the dark still, but they've got a bit cheaper recently, and I'm going to save up and try and have my own, because I'd love to be tracking myself all the time. I really have no worries about the invasion of my privacy.
Well, that's very surprising. I think most people do. I mean, one of the biggest fears, surely, is that we're being watched, not just by satellites, but by videos in the street and so on.
Yes, well, I mean, I can understand on a national or a military level, but on an individual level, what are they going to see? They're going to see me going down the shops. The worst anyone's going to see is me having a wee behind my greenhouse, you know, which my neighbours can see anyway.
So to you, it's kind of holiday snaps, enormously enlarged.
Yes, I mean, it is. Well, it's just fascinating that it's possible that on a sunny day you can think, you know, that it is, if there's no clouds.
Yeah, as Jackie, as an environmental scientist, you have less...
More
perhaps
serious.
Interesting. exactly. What are your interests in this technology?
No, I think personally, I've sort of got involved in this field nearly 20 years ago, and I think for me, what's been absolutely staggering is the way in which individuals, exactly as Robert said, can now look at themselves as a part of the planet. Mm. And from a scientific point of view, I think it actually makes people ask very different questions than they would have done even, say, 5-10 years ago. It makes us look a little bit more carefully at what we're doing, not only to our own planet, but where the whole sort of evolution of the solar system is going.
Well, I think that these observations are part of a whole change happening in environmental science. So we're moving from describing the Earth to predicting what's going to happen if we change something because of climate change, because of the ozone depletion, and all sorts of other things. We need the large models, computer models, of the planet, but we need the observations that can be made anywhere or everywhere, which we can only get from space, as part of the way of teasing out the uncertainties in that problem.
Are you saying that it's possible that we could use remote sensing as a form of monitoring equipment in a big experiment on the Earth? That
one could actually... Already. And I mean, we do for weather forecasting already. Yeah. It's without the remote sensing observations, the skill levels of the weather forecast models would be even less than we perceive them to be already. That we need to know, it's the only way we're going to know what the weather systems are coming into Britain from the Atlantic.
It comes back to what I was saying about having the evidence in front of you. When you have a picture of a weather system passing underneath you and you don't have models that explain it, it forces you to go back to saying, well, do we get the science right? Do we actually understand the sort of physical processes that led us to predict a certain thing happening? Mm-hmm. And it's that confrontation again and again which makes us, I think, refine the kind of scientific models that we've mm-hmm. got and the questions we're asking.
Mm-hmm. David, you're most interested, I guess, in the relationship between the military use of this technology and the growing commercial.
Well, to an extent, that's one side of it. But I couldn't help thinking that what Jackie was saying was really the nub of the whole matter. For 40 years, we've been extending our influence beyond the influence of this planet. And I think the image, the view of ourselves, which was so extraordinarily profound, those of us who are old enough to remember those first views coming back mm-hmm. of Earthrise over the moon, that related us to a cosmos out there. And then the whole Earth, seen as the crew came back home, really did something fundamentally. It kick-started the environmental movement.
Well, let's remind ourselves how we got here with a little bit of history. It all started, of course, with Sputnik in 1957. Living under a Russian satellite horrified the Americans.
I guess the American people alarmed that a foreign country, especially an enemy country, can do this. We fear this. We fear that they have something out that majority of the people don't know about.
The resulting space race saw the rise of military and civilian satellite applications. Astronauts experimented with high-resolution cameras and film. satellite weather monitoring became routine, allowing scientists to track the progress of hurricanes from space. But high-resolution photography was still a military preserve. The existence and capability of spy satellites was a closely guarded secret. In the Gulf War, Saddam's every move was monitored from space. By the mid-1990s, military and commercial technology were converging. Detailed radar observations were being made of polar ice caps and global ocean currents. Today, precise photo imaging of our planet is no longer solely in the hands of the military. Now, David, how did the technology then develop between the military and the commercial? Can you fill us in a bit on the, the history of the development of this?
I think it's important to realize that the right or wrong, and sad or otherwise, the military influence has been dominant both in creating the space race. It was when Eisenhower was unable to get an open skies agreement with Khrushchev that the concept of a military reconnaissance satellite arose, even before the scientific community announced satellites would be launched in 1957 in support of the International Geophysical Year.
Did the military actively try to prevent commercial application?
Yes,
In what way?
The military were concerned that the availability of images would help client states of enemies of the West to obtain information which was crucial to their military aspirations. This happened in the Gulf War, where the French, who broke the mold on that and outside the restrictions that could be implied from a United States Congress, brought in satellites that could have 10 5-meter resolution imagery. And we know that just before the invasion of Kuwait, the Iraqis got that information from the French and used the street layouts of Kuwait, updated to a few days at that time, in order to plan their military occupation of that small Middle Eastern state. So the model is there, it keeps coming back, it won't go away.
But you made an interesting point there about the French sort of breaking out of the mold. Of course, they then had to charge for it, and that was the other side of it, whereas on the American side, what was becoming available was going to be given out more and more to the public. The European race, of course, went very much down the you've got to pay for it as it's produced, which really stifled research. And so you definitely saw a leap ahead in America.
NASA itself has a mandate to offload immediately something becomes developed to the level where a company can make money out of it.
The image we're looking at here is from the Iconos satellite, which is commercial.
Iconos. One, indeed.
But it has
a
resolution of a meter, which used to be the military sort of gold standard, didn't it?
Yes, absolutely.
So
yes,
how
indeed.
Did this come about?
Yeah. Well, this is part of an opening of the waters, if you like, the Moses factor that came in with the Clinton administration, who were determined to crack the monopoly of the National Reconnaissance Office, the central authorizing agency from the early 1960s, ostensibly to prevent competition between the Air Force and the Army and the Navy. And the Marine Corps, for dominance in this information gathering phase.
Robert, I mean, jokingly, you said that you didn't mind the idea of being watched by Zeppelin, but does it worry you the idea of this falling into the wrong hands, this kind of detailed information about where people are, what they're doing?
It's really hard to know, isn't it, as to who would use it? I mean, I can see, obviously, the military applications are the worrying ones from our point of view, but, I mean, very good from the point of view of any potential enemy. I mean, but I think, as from an individual point of view, I mean, having seen Enemy of the State, the Will Smith film, you know, where they're actually trying to chase Gene Hackman and they only see the top of his head and then there's a cloud in the way. I mean, I would imagine there's actually a lot of, if you're actually, I don't know how far the military have got, but if you're actually trying to track one person driving along the embankment in their red Golf, you could lose them very easily, I would imagine, but maybe I'm wrong.
There are technical limitations. We sort of mustn't run away with the idea that these things are hovering, you know, at will over us or at some part in the sky.
They're not geostationary, are they? Are they actually spinning around?
They're not in a position where they spin at the same rate as the Earth, which is about 36,000 kilometres out. It takes you 24 hours.
Right.
To get around the Earth, and hence the Earth rotates at the same rate. Yeah. The Earth is spinning at an equatorial speed of nearly 1,000 miles an hour. So every successive orbit, which takes an hour and a half, moves the Earth 1,500 miles, or almost 3,000 kilometres, westward.
Right.
So you only come back to it, depending on the orbit you're in, at best a few days later over the same track. So you could have done a whole bunch of mischief.
Yes.
That.
Yeah.
Sorry,
yes,
but you
yes,
could.
Yes. I mean, what we're talking about in a way is sort of hypothetically what we would do if information were available, if the military allowed the thresholds of resolution to fall and so on. But of course, it's not just the limitations that are imposed on resolution by people, it's physical limitations that determine what can be acquired. Mm. Robert, I think it'd be very helpful if you could take us through what it is that actually limits the information that you can get from a camera in space.
Well, there are several. I mean, Robert's already mentioned about clouds getting in the way, which clearly is a large limit. And David's already mentioned about the orbit. In terms of an actual image, you have to worry about the size of the telescope. So you need a large aperture in order to be able to view something which is quite small.
But why?
And
why?
Because you need to be able to effectively to collect the large number of photons from an area in order to be able to see this. You also need to have a diffraction limit on the in terms of what you're looking at.
I mean, how long does it take for a camera typically to capture an image?
Mm. How long it takes to fly over, which is a few seconds. Or
a
less.
Few seconds.
Yes, so it depends on how large the area is one's looking at. But we're not just talking about cameras. We're also looking. People work at microwave wavelengths, where the atmosphere is much more transparent. Both with radars, which send out a coherent beam of radiation and then look at return, and looking at what are called passive microwave wavelengths, where you actually are collecting the radiation which is emitted by the Earth. Either at microwave wavelengths, 20 centimetres, something like this, or at infrared wavelengths, so you're measuring the temperature of the planet. Mm. And you can also look at the wobble of the spacecraft itself, and that actually does sound into the Earth effectively, so you can actually infer what the gravity field is, and therefore the ocean circulation. And of course, you have different amounts of water effectively.
Well, as we've been hearing, technology has progressed. These days, you don't need to be a superpower to own a satellite. A new breed of companies is queuing up to put your sensors into orbit. We visited one of them, Surrey Satellite Technology.
Satellite's gone up to the skies. Things like that drive me out of my mind.
Right, here we are in the control station at the Surrey Space Center. This is where we track 13 different spacecraft that we've been building here at Surrey over the last 15 years. On the screen behind me, we can see where they are as they travel around the globe. They don't sit above the Earth in a fixed place the way a geostationary satellite would, but they're sort of whizzing over the surface of the Earth, going from pole to pole in what we call low Earth orbit. That's the kind of orbit that's normally used for remote sensing missions, because you can get much closer to the ground and get much more detail of what you see. This is actually quite a good time to see the spacecraft, because we have two which are being prepared for ship out in a fortnight's time for a launch in 2 months from Russia. This is a 50 kilogram microsatellite, of which we, as our main bread and butter at this company, they're 15 up in orbit. This one will be carrying three cameras. We can see them poking out. They're the circular tubes. Those are the lenses and the lens hoods. The smallest objects we can detect are about 30 meters across. These are typically cost between £2 and £3 million, depending quite what goes into them. And that's very, very different to the hundreds of millions of pounds, which are normally required to build a conventional spacecraft to capture this kind of imagery. Coming down even smaller in size, this is the SNAP Nano satellite, which weighs only 6 kilograms, but carries all the basic components that you need in a spacecraft. A power system, radios for communication up and down, onboard computers, attitude stabilization. We even have propulsion on this. These are the cameras that will be flying on SNAP, so they're very, very small. There's one just there, another one looking down, and there are more on the other side as well. By having lots and lots of small satellites, it gives us many more opportunities to image the Earth beneath us. Because they're small and low cost to launch, we can actually make constellations. And this allows us to get continuous coverage of the Earth, something that you couldn't do with a handful of very large spacecraft.
Amazing technology. Robert, how are these microsatellites going to change our view of the Earth?
Yes. Well, I think that it breaks the mold that we've got into with the space agencies. That what has happened is that, as we were talking about before, is that we needed many more observations of the Earth to understand it of different sorts. And the traditional space agencies were making bigger and more expensive satellites to answer these questions. And then it was taking longer and longer to build them. And the scientific community had a requirement which is much faster than the satellites could be built to answer the questions. And that having these small satellites and this also the whole way of working where we have the scientists and engineers working very closely together to answer scientific questions through a range of size of satellites allows us really to do science which is driven by hypotheses and is risky. Science is inherently risky. And answering questions which are in the normal scientific cycle of 1 or 2 years. We launch the satellite a year or so after we think of the good question to ask for it. And we can do many of those rather than having one satellite every 10 years or every 20 years in the case of the Hubble Space Telescope.
I mean, are we reaching the stage where scientists themselves, basic scientists, without necessarily any commercial objectives, can drive this technology, can commission a satellite, can get the data they need? How do they go about doing that?
They have to have some knowledge of it to be able to effectively, though they can work with the a group of engineers like Surrey Satellites or some of their competitors to work very closely with them to refine us from a general scientific goal to what the exact observation that can be made and then define a satellite that can be built pretty cheaply. Maybe not of the size of a small grant, but certainly not a very large one. And then launch a satellite quite quickly because the launcher business is becoming much more international competitive. And then answer a question in 2 years rather than 20.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's look at a concrete example of the power of combining remote sensing data and computer visualization. In 1996, the Sea Empress oil tanker ran aground, spilling more than 70,000 tonnes of crude oil into the nature reserves around Milford Haven waterway. Using real topographical data of Milford Haven, gathered from three different remote sensors, the Environment Agency produced this video. The top image is looking from the bridge of the tanker. Underneath is the view from the bottom of the boat. This movie shows the correct way to navigate between the rocks, seen as ridges on either side of the black and grey bottom image. This video shows what actually happened. Data from the ship's log was combined with sonar topography of the seabed and aerial views of the waterway. The pilot aboard the Sea Empress drifts out of the prescribed lane onto the rocks, causing an ecological catastrophe. This video was shown in court when the Port Authority pleaded guilty to the case brought against them by the Environment Agency in 1999. Jackie, amazing combination of technologies there, several different forms of sensing being combined. Just shows how important, presumably, the computer processing is in this business.
Well, it was two things. When that actually was put together, it was still a high-risk approach that the agency took because there were no guarantees that the model, the data and everything would come together and actually present in a coherent way that a judge could, you know, visualise what had happened.
I mean, that's what I was thinking, seeing that recreation of the tanker, that actually, I completely bought the graphics. I went, yeah, I totally believe that. And then I actually thought, well, even I know people who could recreate that very carefully or get that data and just adjust it a bit and twist it round so that it sort of went near the rocks or it went right on the rocks. You know, it would. That's where I don't know where I stop believing and start believing. You know,
I think the word integrity kicks in here, doesn't it? I mean, this is really what we're talking about. That inexcusable human tendency to be able to, even with enthusiasm, scientists occasionally massage the data, and there have been public examples of that. But I think also legacy. This is a legacy of the value that comes from the universal access to very large numbers of people throughout the world, both specialists and non-specialists as well.
Well, I think there's a very nice example that isn't a massaging the data, but is a story of how you need to use all the observations together in the discovery of the ozone hole.
Yes.
Of course, the ozone hole was not discovered, although it was observed, it was not discovered using space technology. NASA had a satellite which was observing concentrations of ozone in the stratosphere. But because nobody expected there to be an ozone hole, it was flagged as an error when the ozone levels were this low and was filled in from the observations around it. And so it was only when somebody at the British Antarctic Survey in Cambridge, using quite old technology, traditional technology, was finding these very low levels of ozone, and looked at all the error very, very carefully, and then published this, that was finding these low levels of ozone, that people in the space agency went back and realized the raw data, and realized that actually that our conception of how the ozone concentrations was quite wrong, which had been used in processing the data. And the raw data, which people had not actually looked at, actually did show an ozone hole. And now it's the standard technique that people use to monitor whether there's an ozone hole.
I think there's a very great danger in believing that space can solve everything. It's a tool, it's a mechanism in a tool chest that involves a lot of other practical, technical and scientific applications, and ground truth data, as we call it, getting out there in the field and testing.
Of course, one of the success stories, surely, is in weather forecasting. I mean, it's this kind of image we see, you know, daily on our screens after the news to tell us about tomorrow's weather, and there's no doubt that weather forecasting has become much more accurate. I mean, to what extent has that been a product of remote sensing, the improvement in
very
forecasting?
Very considerably. We wouldn't know what was coming in on the Western approaches if we did not have satellites for being able to help us with this. We'd have very few observations from ships, something of this. We've got here this set of global observations putting together a whole set of different satellite data, actually for a whole 15-year period, where we can see the changes over time of all the weather systems coming across in the tropics and in the storms in mid-latitudes, and the underlying temperature changes of the Earth itself on here. And we can compare these with our, not only weather forecast models, but also now climate models.
But there is a problem, though. There's still this physical limit, which is that even when you've got images like this and you've got a model that we know from nonlinear dynamics, that starting from the same conditions, 5, 10 days later, you'll end up with a different weather system.
Yes.
So again, it's a case of checking what we know, but not necessarily being able to predict the future any better.
Yes.
But this certainly is one of the great success stories of the geostationary position, where you do sit 36,000 kilometres out and obtain this 360-degree view, all but the extreme polar regions. And the World Weather Watch programme, which is a tremendous international tie-up between America, Europe, Japan and some Russian satellites, for a couple of decades now, has been maintaining this total global watch, where the resolution doesn't matter as much as it does for reading number plates or for watching who's walking in and out the supermarket.
I mean, there does seem to be parallels between the internet, the ARPANET, as it started, which is a military application, and this, the fact that you know, when the ARPANET started, for an individual at home to buy a computer, they'd need to first build a house to put it in, and then have about 300 million quid to run it and 40 blokes to put it together. And now you can get one that's that size. And you know, I'm not saying that we'll all have satellites, but the fact is that it's quite conceivable within the next 10 years that a satellite is not much bigger than that.
But through the internet, you see, and this is a typical example of the interrelationship of parallel technologies. Mm. The internet is producing for researchers, for anybody with an internet access or service provider, you can get your daily weather forecast from Mars.
Yes, I do.
He's a Mars Global Surveyor, which is producing weather maps of Mars every day. Yeah. And this kind of liberal availability of information is it's a tricky road to go because of all the dangers that ensue for the future.
I mean, on balance, is this technology good for us? Is it going to save the Earth, or is it going to cause the next war? I mean, what's the balance of opinion about where this technology is going and what its utility is?
I think there are very great dangers with it, frankly, because already developing countries are using commercial imagery to keep watch on their neighbours and indeed plan an advantage, which clearly they see purely because of this technology.
I mean,
it is and was ever
thus. I mean, it's always true of advances of technology can be used for different purposes. I think one of the best the way it guards against it is to make data freely available. But of course, the data on themselves are not very useful. We have to. It's true in military as well as civilian areas that we have to make to know the significance of it. We don't have time to watch everybody going to Tesco's every day.
The overwhelming advantage of this technology is that although at the moment that there's a disparate proportion of haves and have-nots with information, looking just very, very few years down the road, we will all have this information, and there will not be the same separation of the haves and the have-nots. Mm. So it will enable, it will provide that overwhelming advantage, which will suppress those negatives that we fear so much today.
Can you speculate on where this subject's going? I mean, it would be inconceivable 10 years ago that we would be having the discussion we are now. But where are we going to be in 10 years' time, Robert?
I think in terms of the global change and other regional change problems, we will be really quite confident about how we use observations and models together and really start to have much more confidence in the predictions of the consequences and in terms of teasing apart whether there is a global warming, for instance, and how big it's likely to be and what the political consequences of that are like and economic consequences of this are likely to be. But I'm not quite as confident as David that we will actually get all the data available unless there's a political will to do it. I think there's a political imperative to have this change, but we have to make sure that the means of acquiring information don't land in the only in the very few, who might be a rich few rather than a politically important few.
Jackie, how do you see the future?
Well, I think the greatest part is that individuals are going to be able to participate now in contributing to saving the planet. I mean, it's crudely put. If you can see what your little bit of the neighbourhood's doing and then can scale it up, I think that's going to change the whole way in which individuals participate. And I think also it opens up this going down to sort of smaller scale, cheaper, means that young scientists can actually get involved at a very early stage. They don't have to wait till they're some established scientist. They can get involved in asking pretty fundamental questions about the planet and actually do something.
Robert, are you as sanguine as you were at the beginning of this?
No, I'm slightly alarmed. I mean, I've learnt so much through this, but I think that, as Jackie was saying, it's not the view of your house, it's in fact the view of your world, isn't it? That's what would be interesting. And I mean, in my particular case, I've built a house on a bit of land that was at the edge of a village, and it's an absolutely classic thing. And I bet you could expand that and see hundreds of villages with little houses that have been built around them, and then, you know, and you would see the impact. I mean, it worried me on a very local level that I was actually eating into the edge of what was a field with my house, you know, and it was sort of extended out. And it's to see that then on a much bigger level, and that actually then you see that there's forests being sawn down to build that house, and then you can see how many houses have been built with it, how many forests have been sawn down. It changes the whole perception of the way you see what's going on.
I think David made this point very well, and just those images of the Earth from space made us see the Earth differently.
Yeah.
There are three things for the future, surely, which I think are going to be crucial. We're going to be able to ask the right questions for the first time in the whole history of space, so that we know the sort of problems that we're going to be dealing with. We're no longer going to be standing underneath a waterfall digesting vast quantities of information. We're going to be able to discriminate and ask the right questions. We're going to be able to process the information much more efficiently. I remember back in Skylab in 73, 74, we were getting information down from the Earth Resources monitoring packages that was capable of warning Mali tribesmen of a terrible drought that was moving with the southward march of the Sahara. It took 9 months to get that information processed. Today it can take 9 minutes. And thirdly, cost. We're all aware of the wonderful job that satellites are doing around other planets, providing us with the analogues and the feedback for what's happening out there to compare with our own world. The cost of that is so small now that the Mars Global Surveyor, which has been going around for a couple of years, Mars making observations of the weather and the structures, and Mars Pathfinder with its little Sojourner rover that sort of stunned us all just a few years ago, the cost of those two missions was less than the price of three jumbo jets.
Thanks. Well, that's all we've got time for this week. Thanks to Jackie McGlade, Robert Llewellyn, David Baker, and Robert Gurney. Goodbye.